Hello. Oh, wow. That's loud. Hopefully everyone here is here for lightning talks. If you're not here for lightning talks, then you've come to the wrong tent. There are other tents. There are other things happening in other tents. I have been asked to stand up here and speak because clearly I have never spoken at a conference before. And it's important for me to get a lot of stage time because I'm a total diva. So, but genuinely, I started doing talks a few years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. And one of my first talks was a lightning talk, and I really value people coming to see lightning talks. It's a chance for new speakers to try new things. It's a chance for old speakers to try new things. And I love all of the lightning talks. And you've got quite a few awesome lightning talks today. I'm not going to give you a big list, and we're going to have a little bit of fun today. Instead of having all the speakers in an exact order, we're going to play a song. Each one of the speakers has given us an MP3, and we're going to play the first 30 seconds of that song, and they're going to hear their song, and they're going to come up to the stage. Now, a few speakers didn't send us a song, so for them, we might play The Muppet Show. And you can watch the little race condition as they charge up to the stage. So yes, without further ado, I think it's about time to have some lightning talk speakers. I would, of course, like you to give them a round of applause before they even get started, just to warm things up. Okay, good. All right. Health and safety. Let's go.
I need somebody, help, not just anybody, help, you know I need someone, help. When I was younger, so much younger.
Prizes for guessing, this is a lightning talk that has something to do with the first aid team on site, who people come to when they need help with all kinds of things. Some of them are lost and need the toilets, some of them want sun cream, especially today, and some of them have hurt themselves or aren't feeling too good, and that's what we're there for. You might or might not already know that the first aid team on site is all volunteers, and they're all volunteers who, like you, would be at this festival anyway, even if they weren't here doing first aid. So they can be relied upon to nerd out about all sorts of things while you're having a plaster applied. But one of the things about the team here is that we have to keep records of what we do. Some of you will probably know that it's any first aid situation, any medical situation, you have to record what you do. And that can be a bit annoying. It's very important, but it's annoying. So if, for example, I've just used my tweezers here to remove this knotting hack laser crut rabbit from some part of Ben where it shouldn't have got to, then I'm going to have to fill in a piece of paper that says both where I found the rabbit and how I extracted it and how Ben was feeling afterwards so that we can make sure we know what happened at the festival so we can make it better and safer for next time. But also so that we can have some evidence to show that we've provided first aid like we were supposed to and that we haven't done anything we shouldn't have done. But the problem is, and I'll just put my rabbit and tweezers down, that is really inconvenient. If you go to Glastonbury, where we also do first aid, there's a triplicate form on really flimsy paper that you have to fill in a field, often in the rain, and that's not very easy. If you're at CCC, slightly more sensible form, only duplicate, but still a bit flimsy, not very easy to fill in the rain. And finally, London Ambulance Service, they have it the worst. This is a giant form and, you know, lots of boxes to fill in there. And you can see the wind already is catching these. It's also just not very EMF, is it, to have to be playing with lots of these pieces of paper when we thought we might be able to find a better solution to this problem. So I'll hand over to Ben now to tell you what that ended up being.
Hello. So, can everyone see the camera? Is that all working? So we decided we had to sort of show this, actually. You know, I've sacrificed some bunnies to the demo gods, and so we're going to try and do this as live as we can. We had trouble actually mounting the camera on this, so I realized that it's been now taped up with surgical tape. So
do we need to fill in a record form for the use of the surgical tape? We should fill in a form.
We probably should, yeah. So, what we've got here is a Nook, and we decided to use these. We had them 2 years ago, and since then we've improved it a little bit. We've got nice new fancy logos and all the rest of it, and
there goes the paper.
So, the reason we use these is because essentially you can use them in the sun, at night. They're fairly robust. They're also quite cheap. This one, I think, you know, you can buy them now for about 30 quid. So people don't want to necessarily steal them. They're also reasonably hackable as well. So that's that sounds to work. So what we're going to do is we're going to demo how we the kinds of things that we have to record. And so Katie is going to present an injury.
Hello there. Hi. I've hurt my hand.
You've hurt your hand?
Yeah.
Can I see your hand? What's wrong with it?
Well, it's got a bit of a cut and a big bruise.
It's got a cut and a bruise. How did you do that?
Well, there were these two robots having a fight. And
right.
I intervened to stop the fight because I thought it looked a bit unpleasant.
Okay.
And then they turned on me. And so I ran to Notting Hack and had some booze for sort of pain-killing properties. But it's still bleeding, so I thought I should come here.
Okay. And where did this incident take place?
It was down there by the first aid point. But I went off to...
Was it the Microsoft tent?
It was those robots. They went a bit rogue. What can I say?
Okay. So there's a bit of a lag on the camera, so I'm not going to actually sort of type this as I would normally because it's all sort of wobbling everywhere. But essentially what we've got is the incident that we basically fill in, and we record all the roles for the different people that are on site. We've improved this a little bit because we're taking things like email address, because obviously that's more important when you're at a nerdy festival. And so other things that we generally record, things like the primary survey. So this is basically where I would write what happened, what has actually Katie's presented with.
Her hand.
Yep. Yep. So do you have capacity?
Well, capacity would be the ability to make a decision. Depends how much alcohol you think I've had. What do you reckon?
Well, that is something that we added right at the bottom here. It says alcohol or drug suspected. I think I'm going to tick yes.
Uh-oh.
On that one. That's a new one for this year, actually. We didn't have that previously.
Mm-hmm. We also fixed some bugs since last time, one of which we found halfway through the festival and was a little bit embarrassing.
Oh, yeah. There's a bit at the bottom there where it says loss of consciousness. Now, we have a little setting here that basically says if you don't want to have to fill this thing in all the time if you're doing stuff like just cuts and bruises. And you can just say it's a minor wound rest and you just fill in a couple of parts of the form. The problem was is when we selected that option, it said it defaulted to loss of consciousness yes.
So last time, if you got a plaster from us, we will have had to have manually checked whether we'd said you lost consciousness or not.
Yeah.
Luckily, actually, nobody lost consciousness last time, so we were able to remove all that and make them all know.
Yeah. So one thing we have added as well was the fast test stuff, so for anyone who's basically having a stroke. And so the next bit, if I move on, this is a form about observation. So quite often what we do at EMF or at Festival Medical or places where we are, we quite often will treat and then discharge at the scene or in the middle of a field. Sometimes what you want to do is take observations and have people and watch them over time. So I can basically say add an observation and I can keep on doing this. And so what's that on your finger?
This on my finger, this is measuring my pulse rate and the amount of oxygen that's in my blood. And I'm kind of interested because I'm on stage, my pulse is 87, which is higher than normal for me because I'm obviously excited about my lightning talk.
Bit nervous.
Maybe nervous.
Okay, so we can take observations and do that sort of stuff. So treatment given, yeah, I think I'm going to clean that wound and I'll dress it for you.
That would be lovely. Right. Thanks very much.
Okay, so I would dress it. I've got my magic pink tough cuts so I can sort of cut tape up. Which I love. So we can basically fill that in, or if it's just, you know, fill in a couple of tick boxes if it's something simple. Next bit, we squashed this down, actually.
Yep.
Because we don't generally have to deal with this sort of stuff, and if we do, and an ambulance arrives, or we have to do resus stuff, we have they will have their own paperwork they want to fill in.
And it'll normally be massive and in triplicate. And,
any additional
you
notes?
Know, like the stuff you just saw.
Yep. And okay, so the outcome. I think you can you walk? You look like you can walk. Depends how much you've had, right?
It depends how much I've had.
Okay,
it's only
fine.
My hand that's
injured. I'm going to kick you out of my first aid tent now. That's fine. Now, a couple of you will have spotted there's two number nines. Basically, what we do is the last thing. People might refuse treatment, so they have to sign it to say that they have refused and we have offered. So that's kind of an important thing. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to sign it because I've treated you. So put a big X in there.
I'm feeling much better, thanks.
And then what happens is we finish the report form, and right from the get-go, the first version, this version as well, we have taken security to heart, basically. As soon as I do this, it'll encrypt it, and it can't be unencrypted on this device once this happens. It also tells me I haven't filled in a few things, but I don't really care. So essentially, This is now encrypted on the device. If I take it back to the first aid tent, the person with the correct key can now decrypt it if they want to read it in case that someone comes back. But we have to hold all this data for quite a while, and so it's important that obviously not everyone can get access to it. And that's one of the things that we improved this year. We decided to sort of work on the encryption bit and make it even better. So the one thing that I would like to finish with is, yeah, we've improved it a little bit. We're working on all the back office bit because we still need to improve, you know, who gets access to the data, can we see trends, can we actually take this data and use it in a field if someone comes back to us. So we're looking at the back office stuff. We also want to improve this because there's still a couple of bugs, so it needs testing and all the rest. But all the code is on GitHub. So if you search for EMF EPRF or EMF Medical on GitHub, you'll find the repository. And we've had a couple of people already suggesting things that they want. We've had a couple of people download it and build it themselves, come up with some suggestions, and that's really good. And we'd like people to do that if this is the kind of thing that you feel you can help with. So, yeah.
And if you do get involved in fights with robots this evening, there is some really rubbish robots on stage 3. We're there 24 hours a day. You can phone us. We're not in the first aid point overnight, but we're delighted to have visitors. We like visitors who aren't too badly injured. But if you are badly injured, come and see us, please.
Rabbit. All right. Thank you very much.
Is the presentation up there?
Did you put it on the laptop?
Yeah. I sent it to you last night. Is it here?
It's not loaded onto the laptop. I thought you were bringing your own. Okay.
Shall I just start? We've lost 40% of our wildlife in the last 40 years, and we are losing species at around 1,000 times the natural background rate. Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Cheers. Just for the moment. Oops. Yep. There we go. Are you comfortable with a Linux laptop by any chance?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Good. So, is it a PDF? No. So you. Of course, I don't have Office installed. why don't we move your presentation to the Windows laptop, and then. I tell you what we'll do. Could the Love Boat team come and rescue us? Yeah, Love Boat, would you come on up? We'll get your presentation onto another laptop. All right.
Should I just carry on?
It's up to you. I mean, you want to use your slides, right?
Well, I'd like to use my slides, but
okay. They're putting them on the laptop now.
Okay.
love. Exciting and new. Come aboard. We're expecting you.
It's this part.
No?
I have no idea. Does it work?
It does. Yes, it does. Okay. So, hello. We are the Love Boat team, and we are here to talk about cybercrime.
And some balaclavas.
We faithfully replicated the traditional gear of cybercriminals. I suppose a little bit of background about what we do. So, we're pen testers, but we also have a big interest in malware. So, we run a lot of honeypots, we do a lot of research, and it's pretty good fun, but...
Yeah, you know, so sometimes we find things, like, really odd things. So, most of the crap that comes through our honeypots is, you know, script kiddie level nonsense that, you know, you see every day. And then sometimes we just see something a little bit weird, and there was one of them weird things.
By weird, you mean we don't see the same DDoS script every day. But yeah, one time we were looking at something that's very unusual. So again, normally we expect DDoS bots. It's pretty obvious. This time what came down in our honeypot was a sort of a firmware image, right?
Yeah, so what happened was with this crap router emulator running that was emulating some home Soho router firmware and
D-Link, wasn't it?
Which?
D-Link, I believe.
Yeah, it was the D-Link one with that really stupid CGI bin injection bug, and one day something quite entertaining happened. We saw not DDoS.pl or, you know, chitin.c or whatever, we saw just this shell script, and then our emulator rebooted. And we were just kind of like, what the f is this? You know, what even, you know, what's just happened? Something's done something stupid. And what was it doing?
So, what we had actually seen was the first ever, well, was it the first? I think it was pretty much the first.
Well, it was the first publicly reported anyway.
Yeah.
We'd never seen any reports of this kind of thing before. And we haven't seen much involving this kind of crap since. It was like a once off.
So, what it was a malicious firmware image. So the bad guys had basically repackaged the D-Link firmware, but they'd added a few things. So we found a couple of utilities shell scripts, and we also found dsniff.
Yeah. So what this stuff was doing is that you'd dsniff, you'd wput, and you'd a couple other binaries added the firmware image, and then an init script. What the init script did was unboot after this firmware had been written. It would phone home, check for an update. And if there was no updates, it would run dsniff, sniffing passwords going through the router, and then upload the logs to an FTP server on a loop. Now, the interesting thing about routers, you know, I think everyone kind of figured this one out, is that the router lives between you and the cybers, where all the stuff happens, so all your connections are going through it. So it's a perfect man-in-the-middle spot for getting all of your stuff. And this thing was just uploading creds, you know, all your email passwords, all your social media passwords, whatever you were putting through this router.
Mostly pictures of cats.
Yeah, I mean, in our case, anyway, but anything you sent through with credentials in it was being shipped off to these random boxes in Lithuania. And what were those boxes?
So, really interestingly, they weren't what you'd expect. So normally when you see command and control servers, you see sort of OVH servers, standard stuff, just VPSs. What we had found they were using for command and control was point-of-sale terminals, the kind of machine that's sitting in your, like, local coffee store, right? And you're going to put your card through it. These guys had co-opted these to run their botnet.
And there they were with quite possibly the most advanced piece of Linux malware at the time, written with Bash and a few other utilities, and it was infecting firmware. So this stuff will persist post-reboot forever until you reflash your router. And it just is sitting there listening, and it does absolutely nothing except get all the good shit going through your network and send it way over there to Lithuania, where these guys pick it up and they go, oh, thanks for the creds, bro.
Yeah, so... one thing that was interesting is we've seen a lot of router malware. Normally, when we take a deeper look, we find out that they've maybe got a couple of hundred routers at most. But when we started examining their command and control infrastructure, we found a rather different number.
So these guys were specifically targeting German IP ranges, and we found just over 5,000 Fritzbox routers had also been exploited via default credential reuse. And they'd put this firmware on these Fritzbox routers, and this was the first we saw outside of the D-Link spreading pattern. It was because there was a slight issue and somebody may have gained access to some log files and borrowed some things and then looked up the, you know, oh, where are all these bots coming from? And then it was like, oh, they seem to have like hit some small ISP in Germany who's distributing Fritzbox with hard-coded creds and infected all of those. Which is quite interesting because it showed these guys were thinking about what they were doing. They weren't just hitting the internet, you know, entirely, like most script kiddies with some scanner. These guys were going, here's a first world country with all of these really shit routers. Let's hack all of them, sniff all the creds to valuable accounts, and then do whatever crime things we want. So when certain individuals went to gain access to things such as their command and control service retrieve logs, they found that these guys were actively defending their infrastructure, and these guys were actually on the ball. Like, in terms of like malware writing, nothing they were doing was particularly sophisticated, except for the fact that they were infecting the bloody firmware on chip, and you're never going to get rid of it unless you break out a cable and start reflashing stuff, and most consumers are just like, nope. You know, I mean, does your average person, you know, they get the magic box that gives them internet, are they going to be able to reflash their router to get rid of, you know, some firmware level infection? Fuck no. I mean, even for me, that's going to be like, you know, at least a couple of hours of sitting there scratching my head going, oh no, I have to do this? And most of these routers aren't designed to be reflashed, so they'd basically the perfect persistence. They blow operating system stuff, and they were just sniffing everything, sending it off, and it was single-purpose malware. All it was there to do was harvest credentials, send them over there, live on privileged network positions, and just do stuff.
Yeah, so it was a pretty cool deal. Well, obviously not cool because they were evil and terrible and we are totally against that kind of thing. But it was fairly respectable. And it's interesting to note that, so the only other real time we see anything talking about firmware on routers, people like, let's say, Mandiant or other sort of forensics firms, they generally go for like advanced persistent threats, nation state sort of stuff. Looking at those guys, we thought they were just really, really enterprising criminals. It was a very different kind of thing than we'd normally see.
Yeah, so these guys, we don't know who the threat actor was. We don't know what their intention was beyond persist on all of these networks on this specific set of network ranges, live there forever with malware that doesn't really do anything except sit, listen, and call home. You know, it wasn't DDoSing. It wasn't doing any of your normal script kiddie bullshit like sending spam or, you know, packeting people. It was just, it just lived there and it just went, I'm going to harvest all of the creds that go over these pipes, send them over there in batches, and then repeat and never stop. You know, and it also had the feature to, you know, add new utilities to the box and do other things, but they never seemed to use that. They were content with just sitting and doing bulk interception on a very specific target at range. We have no idea who these people are.
But we imagine they do look exactly like us right now.
So, hey guys, nice point of sale systems. Nice malware. You know, can we talk?
Did we leave a message? I don't think we did. We no. Really just sort of looked at them and reported things and wanted them to go away. But we probably should have left a message, I suppose.
You know, because like it was, the weird thing is that Linux Flasher.a was the first of its kind in the wild. There's not been a repeat performance. These guys haven't come back. They've never done this again. They did one run and then stopped. And that's pretty out of the ordinary for crooks and crime and stuff. So, you know.
They're probably a little bit worried about honeypots now, though, so that might be why we've not found them again.
Yeah.
I think we are running out of time. So thank you all for listening to our talk. Have a really great day.
Yep.
Thank you, guys. Wow. So apologies for the technical difficulties earlier, entirely my fault. Simon sent me these slides last night, but as many of you know, I was sleeping peacefully in my tent, getting beauty rest. That's clearly not true, and it's my fault. So I apologize once again to Simon. Could we play Wild Thing for him again? And Simon, come on up to the stage and enjoy the talk that you should have had.
Hello. Take two. I started to give you some numbers. Actually, I got them wrong. It's 50% of our wildlife has been lost in the last 40 years, and we are losing species at 1,000 times the normal rate. Those are not my figures. They're the figures of the most respected scientists in the world. And conservationists are powerless to stem this tide. But technology, we believe, can help. You can help. It's fun and it's rewarding. I'm Simon Hodgkinson. I'm the founder of a new charity called the Smart Earth Network. And we work on these problems. We bring technologists and conservationists together to take on conservation challenges, develop solutions, and deploy them in the field. So we have a tent, actually, which is between here. It's close to the lounge, and please come and see us if you're interested in what we're doing. The way we work is we will only work on real challenges, on real practical problems in the field, and we invite conservationists to pose a challenge. We then work up a concept, working with people like you, who are interested in developing solutions, and then when we know what we're doing, we'll build a team with the right skills, and we'll build a solution and take it to the field. And we also work to raise funds for projects. Often projects have money, but sometimes they don't, and we are a partner of Global Giving, and can raise can use crowdfunding to raise funds for individual projects. So I'm just going to talk briefly about three of the projects we have worked on and are working on. The first is, in fact, the first project that we did, a very simple project, a conservation charity called C3 was trying to conserve the dugongs. This is a dugong off the coast of the Philippines. They graze on the seabed. The trouble is, it's very difficult to spot them. They were using helicopters. It wasn't very effective, very expensive, and they can only stand and be up there for a few hours, and occasionally they found them, occasionally they didn't. The fact was, they just didn't have the data they needed to actually develop their conservation programs. The simple solution was to provide fishermen, who are the people who see them. We provided 50 fishermen with Android phones, GPS. They photographed the dugongs they saw, geolocated them, time and date stamp. And now the conservationists have a map, an evolving map of what's happening with the dugongs around the Philippines, and that provides them with the much more information they had to develop their solution. We did that with, a PhD student developed the app, and then we worked with a mobile operator in the Philippines who provided all the phones. There's the app, there's the map, there's the fisherman. Second project I want to talk about is called Mammal Web. It's a project we're working on with Durham University and the Wildlife Trusts in the UK. It's a platform for citizen scientists to place camera traps in the field to capture images of mammals. Mammals are very understudied. There are relatively few conservationists working on them. They're nocturnal. They're not easy to spot. And we don't know enough about them, and we're losing our mammals. And the idea is to crowdsource information that the government and conservationists need to create credible conservation programs at a national level. We are basically working to develop a new platform. This has already been tested by Durham and the Wildlife Trust up there over the last year, but developing a much more comprehensive and attractive new platform with visualization capabilities and some really cool stuff. Working with a web development agency in Poland, actually, who are initially doing their work on a pro bono basis. I should say that some of the work we do is pro bono, some of it isn't. Some of it is paid normally. But they're doing the first phase, the MVP, as it were, on a pro bono basis. And what we're going to do is work with the Wildlife Trust at a national level to deploy this across schools, make it there are 2,500 schools in the country, and use the kids to deploy the cameras and start to capture the images, which will then feed into national policy making. There's the slide that talks about that. Third project, quickly talk about. We're doing a project in... Oh, sorry, I should have said about the last project that we are having a little hackathon, if you want to call it that, tomorrow, conceptual, to basically discuss a couple of the issues we have. One's to do with big data. The other is to do with creating a camera that is fit for purpose. And if you are interested in participating, please come to see me or Alex. Please wave your hands afterwards, or come to our tent and let us know. They'll be at midday tomorrow. Love to have some of you involved in helping us with that. Last project, we've just come back from a trip to Benin in West Africa, where they have the Pinjari National Park, a vast national park, not as big as W, as they call it, but still vast, 100 miles across. And what we've been doing there is looking at how to create a platform to solve the challenges that a park like that has in a whole range of areas, from ecological monitoring to surveillance using drones to security problems to basic communications and collaboration issues. And we're working with the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, who are the global body NGO that deals with protected area standards globally. And we hope that the platform we build, which we're building with Salesforce, will be one that will be shared by many organizations in Africa and beyond. So how can you help us? Well, please join. Our email is, I should say, our website is smarternetwork.com. Please come to our meeting tomorrow if you're interested in the particular problem of MammalWeb, and help us to conceptualize how we're going to solve those problems. If you're a developer or entrepreneur, we need you to get involved in our projects. Please do. If you're a technology company, we do have a solutions database on our website, which conservationists are telling me is one of the most comprehensive now, and we'd love to have your solution on our site. Thank you very much.
Thanks again to Simon. I have to say, for many years, I performed in circus and burlesque. You can tell
by my fine figure. Sometimes you couldn't eat when you're performing circus, as you can imagine, it's not very well paid. But the audience was always really kind. They would sort of throw rotten vegetables, right? And so you could make a salad at the end of the show, at the very, very least. So I have to say, you are a very, very nice audience, and I appreciate that because of all the technical difficulties that we're having, including, again, now, right? So you can see why The Muppet Show is our theme tune. But I'm really excited about our next speaker, primarily because I have mustache envy. It's not every day that I meet someone with as fine a mustache as mine. And I asked him what kind of wax he used, and he said, Pritt Stick. He genuinely said that. It was just a few moments ago. So I don't know about you, but I enjoy being in a field, here in a shed, listening to talks. And I believe that the next talk is going to be about the Internet of Sheds. Is that, could that even possibly be true? I think it is. Are we all set? I believe the speaker is bringing his own laptop, right? So could we just, no, they're on there. They're on there. Just the URL. Okay, so. Excellent. So as you can see, this is why we queued up the Muppet Show earlier. I try and be ready for these events, but I never am. No plan survives contact with EMF camp. Is everyone else having a good time, though? Yeah? All right. Good. I see a fork bomb in the audience. That's always a good sign, right? Excellent. It is. It's a good one. It's one of my favorites, actually. Fits in a tweet. It's not every day you can get an exploit that fits inside a tweet, right? A couple years ago, someone on the internet asked me how to DDoS something, and so I wrote a fork bomb in Lambda calculus, and I figured, let that script kiddie learn something, right? That joke has never worked for any other audience anywhere in the world. I'm really pleased to hear you guys laughing about that. Cool. This presentation looks really good from up here. Never tell that joke again. Yes? We have internet access. Do you mind? Yeah, let's just cue the music and we'll introduce the next speaker, or let the next speaker introduce himself. Can we have the song?
Let me hear you make some noise! In concert for BBC Television tonight and a fresh start to the week, let me hear you make some noise for Public Enemy!
Hello. First, I'd like to apologize for not being Public Enemy.
Wouldn't that be awesome? Right. Hang on, I've got some words here.
Hello, EMF Camp. How are you doing?
My name is Sam, and this is a story about gardens, renewable energy, and HTTP. F11 for full screen. Right. So about 2.5 years ago, I bought a house with a garden. I'd never had a garden before. Turns out gardening is awesome. And in fact, if you've ever spoken to me for more than about 5 minutes in the last 2 years, I've almost certainly bored you to death about my garden. So here's a picture of my garden.
Is that on?
Is that better? Here's a picture of my garden from June this year. I'm just basically showing off. Turns out the gardening requires a whole lot of equipment. Unless you want to drive your girlfriend nuts by filling the kitchen with shovels and stuff, you need to have a shed. This is my shed. We put this up in 2 years ago. It's got a lawnmower and a chainsaw and kind of garden stuff. But there's something awesome on the roof. Yes, I have. This is a solar panel. So this panel used to belong to my mate Steve, but it was kicking around his flat for ages. He wanted to get a shot of it. So he offered to sell me this and the voltage regulator and a great big battery for a knockdown price. So I snapped it up. So the first lesson is, have a mate who wants to get rid of a solar panel. It didn't come with any fixings. I basically lashed together something here with some straps and some roofing bolts, bits of old pipe. It's all sealed in with silicone sealant and, of course, Sugru. And so inside the shed, I plugged it all in. This is the regulator. Connected the regulator to the battery, plugged the panel into the regulator. The lights came on. The shed faces south, which is extremely handy. The sun was shining. Suddenly, I'm getting some free energy. So that was cool. Steve also chucked in some of these. This is a thing you can connect like a car cigarette thing to, and also 5 volts USB. So the first thing I plugged in was radio, obviously. Now, this may seem like a massive feat of over-engineering purely so I can listen to the test match while I'm gardening. If that seems stupid, strap yourselves in, because it gets a hell of a lot stupider. So what can I do with all of this free energy apart from my solar-powered Jeffrey boycott? Well, I thought maybe I could run some lights down there. So I went on eBay, bought some cheapo 12-volt lights, and I hooked them up to the power outlets, and the lights came on, and it was very exciting. But of course, I've still got these 5-volt USB things. What do we know that plugs into 5 volts of USB? Raspberry Pi, the point down there. This is a Pi 3. It's got the built-in Wi-Fi, which is kind of handy. I stick Raspbian on there. I got a modern Ruby on there, which is still incredibly difficult for reasons I don't fully understand. Got it on my network, and then I could get a shell on my shed, which is very, very exciting for a very small section of people. So let's see if I can switch the lights using the Pi. So I bought this relay. This is a 12-volt relay, connected the lights by splicing the wires across the switch there. Then I found out that this thing requires 5 volts to switch, and the Pi only gives 3.3 volts on the pins. So the second lesson is, sometimes you need more grunt. So this gave me an excuse to play it. Now, I realize this is a very stupid solution, but Arduino. Right, I'd never played with Arduinos before. I was kind of intimidated. Turns out, it's surprisingly easy, especially if you're doing something very, very naughty. Right, this is so easy. I set up four input pins, four output pins. The loop runs. It basically translates the pin one to output pin one. It throws a switch. The light comes on. It's, you know, it's kind of awesome, right? So the next lesson is Arduino programming is easier than you might think. So what about the Pi? So there's a gem called Pi Piper for driving the I/O pins. And it requires root to run. I don't understand why. But it's dead easy. However, the Raspberry Pi pin layout is an absolute shambles. The physical pins do not map to the logical pins. They're all called different things by the different libraries. Maybe there's legacy reasons for this I don't understand and I don't really care about. But without the map provided by these wonderful people, I would have been lost. Pinout.xyz is amazing. So I've got this thing. I can turn the lights on with the Pi. What we need now is a RESTful API. Of course we do. So I broke out my favorite Ruby framework, Sinatra, lashed together a very simple API. So I have an endpoint there. I can hit lights slash name of light, and that does stuff. But then I came up against a thorny issue. So which HTTP verb do we use for this? My first naive thought was, let's do a get. But no, I was told off for that, because that's for getting a resource, right? That tells you what's happening there. So we don't do it with get. Maybe a post. Nope, a post is for creating a resource. Hang on. Put, maybe we can do put. No, a put is for updating a resource. So after extensive discussions with my colleague James over there and my boss Jenny, who used to sit on the technical architecture group of the World Wide Web, we decided the correct approach, because we're changing the state of a particular part of a resource, is patch. This is the right answer. If we're not going to do this correctly, the whole thing is rendered ridiculous. The lesson here, learn to love the HTTP verbs and also waste people's time. It's still not entirely correct. This is interacting with real things in the real world. It's turning on real lights, right? I think it should be done asynchronously via a scheduler, and there should be another endpoint which reports the actual state of the light. In practice, however, I think I've possibly done quite enough here. We can, of course, send a get, and the get will tell me the state of the light, which is fine, except what are we actually getting back here? So we ask the server for the light, and it sends back a 200, and it says, you know, it's returned what we asked for. But of course, it hasn't. It sent back a representation of the state of the light, and it can't even be sure about that because it's an actual thing. It should send back a 303, maybe, which says see other, with a URI for the light. But of course, this is a light that's screwed to the roof of my shed. It doesn't have a URI. This rabbit hole is HTTP range 14. I don't have time to do this now, but if you want to know more, I'm prepared to have opinions in the bar later. Anyway, enough about this bullshit. If you, what does it actually look like? So if you're on my home network and you point your browser at the Pi, you'll see this. This looked much better in Chrome. Anyway, so you can click the switches and the lights come on and go off and it's all awesome. However, there's a massive flaw in this. If I haven't got my phone with me, short of pulling out wires, I have no way of controlling the lights. The most important lesson of all, install some actual physical switches. So what else can we do with this? So I discovered an API. It takes a lat and a long, and it tells you exactly what time the sun goes down at your location. And I thought I could use that to have the lights come on when the sun goes down, and that'd be nice. It was pointed out to me, you can buy solar lights from IKEA that turn on when it gets dark without recourse to anything quite so complicated, but where's the fun in that? And frankly, if I hadn't done this, I wouldn't be speaking to you now. I should implement the scheduler. The name there is from via James. This is never actually going to happen because I've lost interest already. And also, I'm pretty sure I can use all this energy to charge the batteries for my power drill, but I have no idea how to do that. If anybody out there knows how to do that, please come and speak to me. If anybody has any questions or would like to know anything more about gardening, particularly about tomatoes, you can find me in the bar later. There's a load of links here to the stuff. That's me.
Fantastic. I love good lightning talks, as we said, right? Things, when you do a lightning talk, some advice given to me was that it should be brilliant, it should be dazzling, and it should be over in a flash, just like a comet. I can't manage the first two, which is why I ask other people to get up and do lightning talks. And the next speaker worked very, very hard to get a lightning talk into me today, including finding internet, which is not always easy at camp. And then there was a typo in the message, so I never got the email. And then, of course, we needed to get the slides, and we tried to download them over here, and we didn't have email at the same time. And this speaker really made a massive effort to speak today and was not able to give me an MP3. So, of course, we're going to introduce this speaker with The Muppet Show, because, this is The Muppet Show, and I'm the chief Muppet. So we're going to enjoy this, because, like I say, this speaker worked very, very hard to be here on this stage. Are we set up? Nothing yet. Okay, good. I like a show where every once in a while something goes my way, but that's not going to happen at EMF camp, and that's all right. Did anyone spend any time in the bar last night? Anyone at the Robot Arms? I'm a huge fan of the Robot Arms, right? Like, I've been to EMF camp every time, and I see that Robot Arms stops tweeting and then starts tweeting again like a year later. And I always get excited that EMF camp is starting when Robot Arms starts tweeting, right? And I understand from some people that they shipped the Robot Arms sign over to camp. And when they shipped it over, they weren't sure if they should wrap it up in bubble wrap or not, right? Because it's all just kind of junk arms from robots. So do you wrap it up in bubble wrap, or do you just ship it anyway and not worry about it? One of the other things I discovered is a friend of mine. He's a former penetration tester, a younger guy. He came to EMF camp and he didn't bring a sleeping bag, because obviously you're camping, right? And I felt for him a little bit, right? But he told me, it's okay, I can Amazon Prime it. And he had learned that from another friend of mine. And so he did actually Amazon Prime himself, to the best of my knowledge, a sleeping bag. But of course, you were not able to get the sleeping bag from outside the gate, right? The guy had to update the app to say that he had handed off the package, and it had to be inside the camp, but he wasn't allowed inside the camp without a ticket. So what a mess. But we're all set. We're ready to go. Let's queue up the Muppet Show for our next speaker.
Okay, that works. And I can move slides like that? Yay. Okay. So it's not showing on my screen, but I brought my cell phone. Hi, my name is Sai. I am technically required to say I am appearing on behalf of Make Your Laws Advocacy Incorporated. You'll see why in a second. And EMF has not paid me to come do this. They paid me to come do the meditation workshop, which is Sunday evening. I run an anti-super PAC super PAC. And first off, how many of you know what a super PAC is or have heard of Citizens United? Okay, so I'll get to that in a second. How many of you know what liquid democracy is? Couple. Okay, so liquid democracy is the idea that you run a government with direct democracy with transferable proxies. So you can vote on anything you want. You can limit. You can delegate your vote to whoever you want, or have as many people as you want with whatever limits you want, and they can delegate it onwards and so forth and so forth. And where we're starting in the U.S. is money. The reason is that it's kind of a big deal. So why should you guys care about campaign finance in the U.S.? The reason is that it kind of affects you. So there's TTIP, not going to comment in this capacity, but y'all might be interested in that. And unlike other projects, like, for example, the Pirate Party, we have no agenda. We're strictly nonpartisan. We just want to be a platform. So quickly defining a few things. A PAC is a political action committee, which basically takes money from a bunch of people and gives it to spend on campaigns, either directly to give to a candidate's campaign fund, not to the candidate themselves, that's bribery, or by spending money to produce ads. And you may have heard of super PACs. Super PACs are allowed to accept an unlimited amount of money, unlike regular PACs, which can only accept up to a few thousand dollars per person per year. And the caveat on that is that they're not allowed to coordinate. However, if you watch Stephen Colbert, you can see just how loose that means. There's also C4s, which are supposed to be issue advocacy organizations. So if you want to get something on the ballot to pass a law or whatnot, that's where you go. However, in the US, money is speech, more or less literally, technically. Dan Backer, if you're watching, money buys speech. Yes, I know the difference, but anyway. There's a series of decisions from the United States Supreme Court that says that corporations have the right to engage in political speech, that you can spend an unlimited amount of money so long as you're not coordinating, which, by the way, you're allowed to have your campaign manager resign from your campaign and start running the super PAC and listen to your tweets and make ads based on that tweet, and that is not coordinating. Totally. You can't limit how much money people give, and you can't give more money to balance things out. So it's kind of a messed up situation. There's a further step, which is you can actually launder money legally. So if you want more on that, makerlaws.org/FEC/laundering. We have a proposal to ban it. But basically, you can filter money through one entity. So that entity doesn't need to get reporting, but the next one does. So the PAC says, oh, we got money from Anonymous Shell Corporation Incorporated. Where did that money come from? Too bad, you don't need to know. And that is perfectly legal. So just how much money is this? Oh, wait, am I one slide ahead? So we're talking on the order of $1 billion for a presidential election. It's probably going to be a lot more this year. For a state or house race, for a federal house or senate race, you're still talking in the millions of dollars. And also over that period, you're still talking billions of dollars of money spent on lobbying. Unlike in the EU, I know in the UK you manage to have a three-party plus system with first past the post, more or less. Don't complain, you actually have one in Parliament. We do not, unless you count Bernie Sanders. But in the US, it doesn't matter if you get 7% of the vote. It doesn't matter if you get 48% of the vote. It only matters if you get 51% of the vote. So you don't get any seats if you're widely popular at 10%. Too bad, nothing for you. Where does that money come from? It comes mostly from super rich people and corporations and organizations that are allowed to launder money, namely 501c4s. By the way, I run a 501c4 and a super PAC and a 501c3, so I am legally allowed to do that. If you want to know more, let me know. I am one slide behind. Yeah, there we go. So how do we fix this? By having the same tools used for ordinary people. So like I said, I have a super PAC. I can do all the same things that those guys can, except I do it for normal people. So the idea of version one of this is to have a single place where you can make any political contribution and apply some clever things to sort of bootstrap a liquid democracy onto that. So for instance, suppose you follow bloggers who say, you know, donate for one thing or another. You can say to me, or rather to my PAC, I want to donate $50 a month. However, my recommenders suggest we send you an email once a month saying this is the aggregate of your recommenders. And by default, you just sort of opt in. Now, right now, it's not working because we need code. I'll get to that in a sec. But it is legal. We also are allowed to accept Bitcoin. That is a proposal that I wrote. And I actually killed a previous Bitcoin proposal that had a lot of legal loopholes. But if you are a US citizen or a permanent resident, you are allowed to give Bitcoin to my PAC. If you're not, you can give one, give Bitcoin to our C4 or C3. There we go. Wait. I can't. There we go. Yeah. So liquid democracy basically exists. So these relationships that I'm talking about, where you have, you know, proxies, you have those. It's just that they're not transparent. And in theory, you could be a proxy even if you're not a US citizen, because a US citizen is the one deciding how to spend their political contributions, not you. Like I said, non-US citizens are allowed to participate in issue advocacy, C4 organizations. So if you wanted to influence laws, not lawmakers, so if you wanted to change how a particular trade agreement might go or what laws are enacted in the US, that is perfectly legal and you can do it anonymously. And I would like to help. In order to do that, however, I do need help from you guys. Like I said, you can help by donating money, but more interesting, you can donate code, because I convinced the FEC perfectly legally and like legit. This is, it's on, go to the FEC website, it's there. Code does not technically count as a thing of value under US campaign finance law. Because we're open source and because it's all volunteer. So your services, just like Elton John playing a concert for Hillary Clinton, which happened, it is perfectly legal and there's no problem with that. So if you're interested in contributing, please do. Contributing code, especially. So the difference for us is we're nonpartisan, open source, it's all on GitHub.
except for some legal stuff, so that can't necessarily be public. Open source licensed, it's all on Rails, and yeah, if you have any questions, please come let me know. And I'm running on Sunday meditation workshop, and in the evenings, if you want to learn how to navigate with a cane, one of these, this is my actual guide cane, and yes, I am actually blind in light. So just come talk to me. So yeah, thanks.
Fantastic. So we've had a crazy session today. We had a couple people show up at the last minute. We lost some slides, which is entirely my fault. The next speakers have to set up a lot of equipment, and that meant that we had to cut off Charles Yarnold. I apologize for that, but he will be speaking at tomorrow's Lightning Talk sessions at 11:50. So come and join us again for another set of Lightning Talks tomorrow. I hope you had a good time and look forward to the next session, which is the Geek Show Off. Thanks again for being a wonderful audience and supporting all the Lightning Talk speakers. Have a good time.